Okay, ladies, please. Ladies, please. This lady from Rutgers University, she's doing a presentation of Rutgers oral history.
All right, can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
My name is Molly Graham. I'm the assistant director of the Rutgers Oral History Archive. I also run a nonprofit doing oral history in Maine, where I'm from. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself, my work, and then what we're doing at Rutgers and how you can be involved. My background is in radio documentary work. I used to be kind of a long-form narrative reporter, and then I needed kind of a real job, so I got my master's in library science. And halfway through my graduate work, I realized I could do two things I loved: preserve life stories told in the voices of those who lived through it, and also preserve history at the same time. So I got into oral history. Does everybody know what I mean when I say oral history?
Yes.
Okay. So I told someone recently what I do for a living, and he thought I studied mouth bones. So it's not that. We're preserving history through voices and stories, again, from the person who lived through it. That way you're capturing the content of someone's life, their life events, their military service, their education, their family, but also the context in which their life was lived. New Jersey history, the Depression, the war, the Civil Rights era, up to present time. So after graduate school, I was hired as the director of an oral history program for a veterans museum in Madison, Wisconsin. And my job there was to go around the state and interview veterans from World War II to the present. And so we talked to, I think I did hundreds of interviews while I was there. Everyone has a different story, and every story should be heard, preserved, and made available for the future. There's sort of two purposes to doing oral history. It's to preserve the story for the person and their family. That way, your life story will be available for many generations to come. But it's also to make this information available to researchers and scholars. One of my first days in Wisconsin, an eighth grader came into my office and he said, "You know, I didn't get to know my grandfather very well. He passed away when I was young, but I know that this program interviewed him a number of years ago. Do you have that interview?" So I was able to find that interview and set the kid up with some headphones, and he got to hear his grandfather talk about his whole life. At some point, I was making sure that everybody who had participated in the program had received a CD copy of their interview. So I was calling folks up to let them know that these interviews existed. I digitized them. Before I got there, they were all recorded on cassette. When I do interviews now, they're all recorded digitally, professionally. They sound crystal clear, like you're right there in the room with somebody. And this woman said, "Oh, I didn't realize my husband had done this interview, but he's since passed away." So I sent her a CD copy of that interview. She called me up the following week and said, "It was like he was right back with me for the weekend." And so what I try to capture when I do oral history is something I call felt life. It's a term borrowed from Henry James, and it means not just what happened and when, you know, I did this, then I graduated, then I did this, but really what every moment felt like. We kind of travel back in time with people, have them take a look around and describe the sights, the sounds, and the feelings. I interviewed someone whose ship was torpedoed in the Pacific during World War II and is being shot at by kamikaze pilots, and he was stranded in the water for 4 hours. And I said, "What was that like?" And he goes, "It was wet." And I said, no, "What were you thinking?" And then he talked about his girlfriend back home, his family, all the things he hoped to do and wanted to do and didn't know if he could do. Another guy I interviewed, a Vietnam veteran, at the program in Wisconsin, it was mostly, I was the only female interviewer, and I was the only non-veteran interviewer. A lot of the other interviewers were veterans, and sometimes, especially with Vietnam veterans, they wanted to talk to another Vietnam veteran. There's a common language, a shared experience, they felt more comfortable. But I got a call from a Vietnam veteran who said, "Molly, I want you to do my interview, and I want to do the interview at night in my barn. And I thought, well, I'm not so sure about that. But we negotiated a little bit, decided to do the interview during the day. I go to his house. I could have been the last person on earth in Wisconsin. I was in, you know, Nowheresville. I drive to his property. It's this big farm in Wisconsin. He's this huge guy, and he comes lumbering out of his barn. And he kind of beckons me into the barn, and I think, oh, this is it. You know, there's all this antiquated farm equipment on the walls, and he takes me into this back room where there's kind of a grate on the ground where I think he's going to put me in the lair. And I think, well, at least I'll die doing what I love, oral history. But it turned out all of his requests for this interview were indicative of his life experience and his war experience. He likes to be up all night because he's still so vigilant. He has so much leftover PTSD from the war that being in his barn, the highest point of his property, is where he can see all around him. And during this interview, he stood up and started stomping, and I didn't know if his foot was asleep or if this was for emphasis, but he had traveled back in time, and he was taking a hump in Vietnam, and he was kind of in the action. So you're sort of reliving someone's life with them. And so I really loved that work, and I love doing military oral histories. I left that job, returned to Maine, and started a nonprofit there doing oral history in Maine. I did two large projects, one documenting the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. These are people who had been instrumental in the disability rights movement. Well, it was only in 1990 that Congress passed a law saying discrimination against people with disabilities is against the law. And even since then, not much has changed. It's not a law that's enforced very often. You often go into restaurants, and if you're in a wheelchair, it's hard to get around. I even hosted kind of a story slam where people who had various disabilities, hidden, invisible, some who were blind or deaf or in a wheelchair, and to even find a venue to accommodate these folks was nearly impossible. And so the project kind of documented how far we still have, you know, how far we've come, but yet how far we still have to go. Also with my nonprofit, I did a project doing immigrant voices stories. And so these are people who have come from all over the world to Maine, which is the whitest state in the country. And these are people who have survived the Rwandan genocide, the Holocaust. The one woman was 5 years old when she was sent to the Cambodian killing fields. And she lost every member of her family, every immediate member, every uncle, every aunt, every grandparent. But there was no bitterness in her voice, and the way she contributes and gives back to a community that doesn't always accept her is so inspirational.